Pastor's Corner. I know that you usually enjoy the Pastor's Corner. And so this morning we are here to discuss a very, very interesting, relevant, and important topic today. I wouldn't reveal it as yet. As time rolls on, I will reveal it. And so today I have two wonderful gentlemen who will be expounding this topic today. And here I'm going to give them the opportunity, even before we pray, to introduce themselves, and then we will pray. So I'm going to give you the opportunity to introduce yourself.
Thank you, Pastor Guillaume, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen, viewers all. Welcome again to Pastor's Corner. Of course, I'm Pastor Enoch Isaac, the Ministerial Secretary of the Grenada Conference. I'm delighted to be with you again, another Pastor's Corner. Good morning.
All right, a pleasant good morning to our saints, our good Christian friends, brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, and also those that are online viewing us today. And so I am by portfolio Pastor Bernard Lyons, and of course, a proud worker of the Grenada Conference of Seventh-day Adventists.
All right, so you have heard them. They have introduced themselves. And I know that they will do a wonderful job in expounding this very, very important topic. I want you to share the page, invite others to be a part of the Pastor's Corner. And I'm certain that you will be tremendously blessed. And so at this time, I invite you to bow your heads with us as we pray. Dear Father and God, we give you thanks and praise for today. We thank you for your goodness and your love towards us. We thank you for your wonderful words of life. We thank you that in your words, we can find the principles and truths that we can live by even today. So even as we look at this very important and relevant topic today, we pray, God, that your Holy Spirit will guide us into all truth. Be with the panelists, even as they deliberate, as we discuss this very important topic, and may it be a tremendous blessing to our viewers and listeners out there. So, Father, we just ask for your mercies, your forgiveness, and may you lead and direct, take full control of this episode of Pastor's Corner today, we pray, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Once again, I want to welcome all of you online. I'm seeing Elisa Watson, Marcia Philip, Raul Ferguson, Michelle Langine. It's good to have you here. And I know as we proceed, many more will join in. And so I want to bid you welcome to another episode of Pastor's Corner. I just want to take the time before we begin to ask the questions to promote the crusade that is now on. I must say that the crusade is going well. The preacher is really on fire for Jesus Christ. He's really expounding the word. And if you are missing out, you cannot afford to miss out anymore. And so it's a Caribbean union-wide. As a matter of fact, we have 5 English-speaking unions who have joined together to have this mega crusade. And the theme for the crusade is Footprints of Hope. Footprints of Hope, walking with Jesus. And the evangelist is internationally known, Pastor Glenn O. Samuels of Jamaica. And the crusade begins 7:30 nightly. Remember, it's a virtual crusade, so you must log in order for you to be a part and to be blessed by this wonderful experience. And so right here, Mission Life, Facebook and YouTube, you can log in every night, 7:30 p.m., and you will be tremendously blessed. I need not say more, but we have a special promotion in store, so we want you to just take a look at this special promotion at this time.
Many persons are looking for the key to a meaningful life. And they've discovered it's not liquor, it's not sex, it's not money, it's not fame, it's not fortune. Yes, the Bible has the answer. It is Jesus Christ who is the hope of the ages. Join me, Glenn O. Samuels, in the Footprints of Hope, Walking with Jesus, evangelistic series, live and in living colors. See you.
All right, welcome back again. And I want to encourage you to encourage others to join in this wonderful experience, this mega crusade that is held online. You can share the link with your neighbors, your friends, your co-workers, you know, and encourage them, because in these days that we are living in, with all of the COVID and all of those Omicron and all of those diseases that affect us, you know, we have to look up for hope. And there are many persons who are just looking for that hope, so we can point them to none other but Jesus Christ. So I want to encourage you, please share the link, please invite, please encourage others to be a part of this wonderful experience as we seek to break the evangelistic glass ceiling by the Holy Spirit. And so today, I again have two wonderful gentlemen with me. And the topic that we're going to look at today, very important topic, I know that you will enjoy it, consulting your higher powers. Consulting your higher powers. We do believe that there is a higher power, but what is that higher power that we are really speaking about this morning? As you listen up, as you tune in, you will be blessed as the panelists, they will answer the various questions. I know that they are experts, and they have all the information there, so that they will share with you. So right off the bat, we go into question one. Question one, who or what is considered to be a higher power? Pastor Lyons.
All right, thank you very much. Who or what is considered to be a higher power? I believe if we go to the definitions that the dictionaries would have, we can come up with something that says a spirit or being that has great knowledge, power, strength, that is able to affect nature and the lives of individuals. So it's a greater being, a spirit that is beyond our human capacity to comprehend, if you please.
Pastor Isaac, would you want to share?
Well, to just to add to what Pastor Lan said, higher, you know, that's an adjective. You're higher, tells you something beyond the human capacity, you know. And we are created beings, human beings. We are mortal. That means we can die. So a higher power has to be a power that is what we call immortal. Okay. That a being that cannot die, you know? Because a higher power can't be, well, in the realms of humanity, you say, okay, the prime minister is a higher power, the president, you know? We're not referring to that. We're talking about something beyond the human being. Mm-hmm. So, of course, positional power, based upon the position you hold in the human sphere, you're of a higher power. But in this sense here, I think the question is talking about something beyond the human realm. And I would say the question is who or what? I would say the gods, Pastor Guillaume, or God. You know, using the term of Daniel chapter 2, the gods. Yeah. Those that are, whose dwelling is not with human beings.
All right.
You know, using that term.
Yes.
I have to be careful. Somebody say, Pastor, they're saying gods. Well, of course, that I'm not referring to the God or God. But there are beings besides God. The Bible says in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heaven, and the earth. And that is the higher power. But besides God of the universe, there are other higher powers. I think we probably will get into it.
All right, very interesting.
Even to add to that,
yes,
I think we can look at the whole concept of that higher power is somebody or something that you pay homage, respect to, that you look up to. It is beyond you, and so you are submitting yourself. You are humbling yourself in the presence of or before that higher being or that higher power.
All right. Michelle Langein, in answering the question, she says, my only higher power is God.
Yes, man.
And the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Okay.
Kimmy Patterson says, above all else, and that's our Jeremiah, is saying, thank God for his higher powers. But as you rightly say, that there is a higher power. God is our higher power. And as Pastor Isaac mentioned, when he says in the beginning, God speaks about Elohim. So he is Lord of Lords, King of Kings. But here, the question is, should Christian consult with the world of the supernatural? The supernatural. Mm. So Pastor Isaac, you mentioned about other gods. And I believe that you are speaking about common G gods, not capital G gods. And it appears as though these common G gods are supernatural as well. So the question is, should Christians consult the world of the supernatural?
Great question, Pastor. And I believe the thing is, off the bat, when persons hear about the supernatural, their minds generally trend in a particular direction. You know, I would say all minds, evil, supernatural. But no, the world of the supernatural is good and is evil. We can't get away from it. The world of the supernatural. Remember the term, supernatural. It's above natural. We are in the world of the natural. You and I, we are human beings. That's the natural world. But the world of the supernatural, beyond human being. The question is, should we consult them? Yeah, I think we should. We should, Pastor. In James 1:5, the Bible says, if you lack wisdom, if any man lack wisdom, something that you don't have in the natural, you should ask of God. No, that's supernatural. You're asking of a higher power, a power that is beyond you. So yes, the world of the supernatural. Now, we have to be very careful now. The world, should we consult the world of the supernatural? I would say yes, but only the righteous world. Yes, you know. No, I have to be careful because you see, when you say supernatural, we can go either way. You know, the world of the supernatural, Pastor Guillaume, comprised of good and evil. You see, the world of the supernatural comprised of good and evil. And I'm saying, yes, we should consult the world of the supernatural as it relates to good, as it relates to Jesus, as it relates to God, as it relates to Genesis 1:1. In beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. If you lack wisdom, the Bible says, ask of God. That's the supernatural. And that's the one I believe we should consult. I would say something further on the other world, on the other side, maybe after Pastor Lyons respond.
All right. For me, in context, as we speak about higher powers and should we consult, as was mentioned before, and even on the screen, my higher power, which is God, we know that God, and what distinguishes him from others is his omnipotence.
That's right.
He's all-powerful. He's omniscience.
Yes.
He's all-knowing and his omnipresence. He's everywhere.
Amen.
And humanity, a human being, a mortal being, cannot do those three things. And that sets him apart. And of course, God himself is holy.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, it says that heaven is his throne room.
Amen.
And the earth his footstool. So that alone shows you the kind of authority and awe and respect that we should give to our God. And even the angels in heaven, they fall themselves prostrate at his feet. That is a demonstration of respect and homage to God. And so, should we consult God? And I say, should we consult God, which is a higher power than we are? Then we say yes. And Hebrews 11:6, it says, without faith, it is impossible to please him or to please God. For he that cometh to him must believe that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And I would further add, one of the reasons why persons go to a higher power is not merely to pay respect or homage, but a lot of times they want something or they want to know. Mm-hmm. And so, even though I'm adding this now, even though you cannot see, because most persons, they appreciate a God that they could see, a God that they could touch. But for us, as Christians, we know that it is by faith. We have not seen, but we believe.
That's right.
We have heard about it. We have read about it, but we have not yet felt him and touched him. We have not yet felt the nail prints in his hands. We have not yet touched his feet with those nail prints, but we believe that God exists. We believe that that higher power is there to sustain us. He keeps us. And by faith, we believe that God is able. And so we consult God because he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Amen. Amen. Very well. So our panelists, they are doing very well in discussing the topic. So question number three, what are horoscopes? So we are talking here about the supernatural. And we mentioned that God, we do believe that God is the only supernatural God. And as you rightly said, Pastor Lyons, he's omnipotent, he's omnipresent, he's omniscient, and all of those things. Yeah? But there are persons who consult other higher gods, even in horoscopes. So what are horoscopes, and should Christians believe in horoscopes?
Okay. So when we look at horoscopes, I see Pastor Isaac, you're warming up. He's warming up, so I'll just take my time and go fast so that he could come in and start batting. So horoscopes, when we speak about horoscopes, it's almost like saying you're speaking about telling the future, knowing what's going to happen and so on.
Yes.
What's going to come, because as human beings, we don't know. That is why we are mortal, but that higher being knows everything. So we don't know, but we always want to know. And so those horoscopes is as though it helps us to understand and know what's going to come and to see how things are going with us beyond what we actually know and so on. So it's almost like saying you're consulting the higher powers to see, as they say, how your light burning, how things are going with you. And you just want to know. It's just about having knowledge beyond what you probably should have at the current point in time. But herein comes again faith, and you ask, should we consult horoscopes? Well, Matthew 6:33 says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So even if we do not know what the future holds, and we do not know what is going to come, and we do not know how our light is burning, what the Bible says is your best approach is to seek God first. So even if you thought the other beings, supernatural beings, were greater because you could hold them, you could touch them, you could pray to them, and so on, even if you believe, God is still greater. And he says, seek ye first God and his righteousness and all those things, all what you want to know and so on. God is going to give you the confidence and faith to be able to handle the circumstances of life and to get what you need so that you can be an overcomer, and also your cup can be full and overflowing in Jesus' name.
All right, so Pastor Lyons, I just want to ask a little follow-up question here. So is it okay for me to believe in God, the supernatural God, the omnipotent God, but still consult my horoscope every day to see what it holds, the All day right. holds. Is okay. it okay for okay. me to do that?
All right. Good question. Now, the thing is, if you believe that God is the ultimate, God is supreme, and you have faith in God, then why should you go to a secondary source? What you are basically saying is, the first source is not satisfactory. I'm not getting what I want from the first source. So I have to consult a second source, which discredits God and places him in a compromising position. Because then, when he is proven and tested, it doesn't seem as though he is coming true. So you have to consult something else to see whether or not God is true or whether or not God is authentic. And then you realize, well, wait, no, that doesn't make sense. If I trust God, I trust God. And I believe in him, he's going to direct my path, and I just live my life in accordance to the will of God. So I need no other individual or
person or supernatural being. God is sufficient. He's God all by himself.
That's right.
He's a majority.
Amen.
He's sufficient. Amen. He's complete in all his ways.
That's right.
He's perfect. And we need nothing else. We don't need to add anybody else, anything else. God by himself is just enough.
Amen. 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 Pastor Isaac, yes, Pastor, you want to add anything?
Of course. As Pastor Lyon said, you know, horoscope is really a forecast of someone's future. Based upon the position of the stars or the all planets right. when that person was born. Yeah, so the people who study, well, I think we have it there, we'll come to it, but astrology,
yeah.
they come up with horoscopes based upon, and they say everyone has, you know, when you're born, you're falling in one of those 12 zodiacal signs. So based upon where the stars were and based upon where the planets were when that person was born, then they develop a horoscope. So people consult that for daily movements and living. Now, you know, I remember a few years ago I was in Taipei, and you know, it's fascinating, Pastor Guillaume. You know, yes, you know, the capital of Taiwan.
Okay.
Those huge temples there. I mean, mm-hmm. Not simple people. You're a banker, you're a lawyer. It doesn't matter who you are.
Yes.
People do nothing. I mean, absolutely nothing without consulting those zodiacal signs. Mm. If you're going to expand your business, you're going to plow $3 million more. If you're going to marry, if you're going to... I mean, just whatever you do at midday, the folks come, you pay. And that's either a crystal ball, or something has to be spurned, and whatever it says by the letter, that's how they function. They do nothing else with their life except what the signs say. So, and similarly in the Western world, we don't have those because, you know, we're in the West, but folks consult the horoscope. Now, this in Asia, you know, they go to the temples. So they follow the signs. Whatever the sign says, that's what they do. And you asked a question to Pastor Lyon, should we consult, should Christians? And I would say no, because we have God.
That's right.
You see? Amen. And that's the other supernatural. And yes, and I'm saying it, and don't get offended, folks. Yes, it's a supernatural power. Sometimes we play as though he's not, but there is another supernatural power, less powerful than God, but nonetheless, we are no match for him. You see, the Bible says he was created. He was fourth in line. I mean, the Bible, Isaiah chapter 14 and Ezekiel chapter 28 tells us about this man. And God threw him out. He was once Lucifer, now he's the devil. He's in the world of the supernatural. So that's where the other power, right? Trying to rival God. Notice how he said trying, because he can't rival God. God is all powerful. He has some power.
That's right.
But God is all powerful.
Correct.
But that's where persons, Pastor Guillaume, and I want to practicalize it because from a baby, you know, a baby is born into the world and the mother or the grandmother puts something on the baby's hand, some black and red bead. It means something, a power. They're giving credence to a power.
Maldrew.
You ask them, Pastor Guillaume, you say, Maldrew, I'm not sure what is that. But you ask them, why do you have this on the baby's hand?
Yeah.
And they would say, to protect them.
Yes.
You see, power. We're talking about power.
Yes.
Consulting the world of the supernatural. And I would say to a mother, why do you allow that? Not me, Pastor. The grandmother did that. I'm not sure what's about those grandmothers. I've never heard the grandfather. There's always something about those grandmothers out there.
Yes,
be careful. If you want to give your child, make sure that the child is covered and make sure that the child is covered under the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
The blood of Jesus. So no red, red and black bead or any kind of bead can put. So I'm saying this horoscope stuff is not of God. It is not of Jesus. It is in the world of the supernatural, yes, but in the underworld, the demonic world, I must add. So yes, in the world of the supernatural, but it's not a godly power. We must consult God and God alone, not horoscope.
Amen, amen. You know, it's good that our viewers, they are participating in the discussion, and we have some very interesting comments here, so we just want to share some of those comments. We have Avian Mason saying, horoscope competes with the Bible meaning. The Bible tells us everything we need to know spiritually and physically, but a scope gives persons an immediate answer. Horoscope reading is people who communicate with the devil. That's why so many people are gambling their dreams on horoscope reports. The report from a horoscope never leads a person to Christ. People accept the destination as given with a horoscope. The Bible gives us repentance. Elisa Watson is saying, that's lack of faith in God right there. And, you know, there are some other comments. Michelle Langan is saying, the black and red is traditionally, so I won't say supernatural.
All right. Pastor.
Black and red is traditional. That's Michelle Langan is saying, black and red is traditional, and I won't say supernatural.
Yeah. I guess we could do a follow-up and possibly recognize that different persons have different view. Yes. Of the things that they do. So to one person, it may seem like a tradition.
Yes.
And to somebody else, it is beyond that. For most persons that I've seen with it, it is for the same reason of the maljo, mm-hmm. or protecting them from persons that may seek to do evil upon them, which to me tells me that persons believe that there is bad,
yes.
bad in the world. So they put on those items to protect them from the bad, or the evils that exist. So different persons have different meanings and perspectives to those items that they have on.
Yeah, we don't want to prolong that, Pastor, but clearly, you see, that's how the enemy works, you see?
Yeah.
So tradition, but tradition is steeped in something that the folks don't understand. Why? It's a tradition, but where does it origin? What propelled the tradition? What created the tradition? Mm-hmm. It's because in the world of the supernatural, there is good and evil, you see? So the person, I don't blame the person. They're saying, "Oh, yes, it's
traditional.
It's traditional. Yes. It is traditional, but the tradition is steeped in something.
That's right.
Yes, that's where it came from. It's a belief. You shall be protected by whom? There are only two powers in the world: good and evil. Yes. And I'm saying to our viewers and listeners, you do not have to put red and black or any color bead on your hands to be protected. You call on God of the universe to protect you. That's the point I'm trying to make. So you don't have to believe something. It's traditional, but it's a subtle power, you know, and I think we have to be very careful with that.
Amen, amen. You know, interestingly, pastors, God used a star to guide the wise men to the manger where baby Jesus was born. He used a star. So the question that I want to pose to both of you, should Christians believe in astrology and the sign of zodiac?
Okay.
Well, you know, Pastor, there's a difference. Yes, of course, in Matthew chapter 2,
yes.
The wise men coming from the east, you know, Eloi does say to us that that star was a distant company of all the angels, you know.
Yes, yes. Yes.
But yes, God used that shining object in the heavens to guide the wise men, as we were told, that they studied the bodies of the heavens. So there is a difference between astrology and astronomy, which is, astronomy really is a science which studies the heavenly bodies.
All right.
Planets, stars, constellation, they study them. You know, you can study them and see, you know, how they function and come up with theories. And every now and then you're told that they make some discoveries.
All right.
The planets, that's astronomy. Astrology, on the other hand, is a false science. It's called a pseudoscience. There's no science behind it. It's a belief that those heavenly bodies, there's a saying in astrology that whatever is above affects, determines what happens on earth. So while astronomy is a study, is a science of the heavenly bodies, and we know they exist, God created them, astrology, on the other hand, is a belief that the position of the star affects you. That's where horoscope come from. You see, that's what I'm saying. So, yes, God used the wise, directed them. That's astronomy. They're studying this. They knew it meant something. That shiny object, that star. Although they couldn't, they knew. That's why they said, "Where is he that was born King of the Jews?"
Yeah.
It meant something. It's the body, that shining body in the heaven. They didn't understand what it was, but they knew it meant something. Yes? And God used them.
That's right.
Astrology says to us, today, you may have your knees hurting you, or you shouldn't go to work today. Because when you're born, the position of the star was this way. You shouldn't go. If you go to work today, something will happen. You'll die on the way. Any belief, anything that it tells you, you should. People who play, they play a lot of stuff. It's the same. That's those right. are the same things. You know?
Sure. Yes. Yes.
People, you in the supermarket, people saying, "Well, you should play Scorpion today. You must play it." It's all kinds of belief, false belief, demonic belief. Right? Of course, we don't believe in playing lotto or playway or any such things. But I'm just telling you, that's the basis from where these things come from. Astrology. What you believe, how you do what you do, is based upon... But there's no science to that. The Bible, I don't believe we should believe in astrology. I believe we should... Astronomy is a science. Like chemistry is a science, yes? Astronomy, fine, but not astrology. I defer. I disagree. That you know, as Christians should believe in astrology. I believe we should believe in astronomy, the science of astronomy, telling us more about the heavenly bodies as men use the telescope and all this other instrument to help us understand. And they can only help us because they are not the ones who created it. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, astrology, we have to work carefully with that. That's where the horoscope and thing comes from.
All right. So before Pastor Lyons gave his input, it appears as though Michelle Langein is challenging you, Pastor. Pastor Isaac, she's challenging you. She's asking, so Pastor Isaac, our African ancestors have a lot of traditions. Are you saying that they are all evil?
Well, of course, I could not have been saying that because I didn't say all traditions.
Okay. Context.
Yeah, so a broad statement. For me to say that, Pastor Game, you have to pick up, you have to get every tradition and you have to examine it. Yes. Now, for the Christian, ultimate decision or what we believe or what we disbelieve is based upon the word of God, the Bible. Any tradition, I can make that kind of broad statement, any mm-hmm. tradition that is contrary, that does not get support from the Bible, should be rejected. Mm-hmm. So I cannot sit down on this program and say, who will say any tradition comes from? So the African tells us we must pong cassava and make firing, and okay, that's a tradition. Okay, cassava is good. We pong it and we eat it, we could grind it.
Yes.
That's a tradition. If you know what I'm saying.
Yes, yes.
But any tradition that goes against the biblical mandate, a standard, once it cannot be supported by the Bible, yes, we have to be careful with that because and we should be rejected. We talk about the, Saraka.
Saraka.
Is that the term? Where they have it sometimes in River Sally and other places where certain times having the food.
Yeah.
And then they have to call the spirits and stuff like that. But you can't just eat the food like that, you know. You have to, the spirits have to be invoked for us. And other things that came from Africa. We have to be careful. Which spirit are we invoking? Are we praying? If we have our meals and we pray to God about our meals, over our meals, ask him to bless it. If it's not God blessing our meal, any other person attempting to do anything on anything we have to be careful with it. Because I said, remember, it's good and evil.
That's
so right. if it's not from God, if it's not God bless, forget it, Pastor. It doesn't matter if our African people gave it to us or it came from our Asian friends. It really doesn't matter where it came from. If the Bible
yes,
can't support it,
that's right.
Forget it.
Transcends tradition.
Yes.
All right, very nice.
All right.
You want me to weigh in? All right, no problem. Well, of course, on the question that we have at this time, as was mentioned before, everything really points to basically the same thing, knowing what is going to happen, knowing what to do, what decisions that you should make. That's basically what almost all those signs, horoscope and the zodiac and astrology and so on. And I believe what we should be mindful of is not to spiritualize everything, or not to put everything in a spiritual context, a supernatural context. So you pass by and you probably see a tree waving and then you say, the spirits are waving to me. Nature is waving to me. Mm-hmm. And so you make it something of a spiritual significance. Or there are persons who they see an animal born in some unique way and that animal automatically becomes a god. Of course, we're speaking about the stars. Let me answer two ways. One, Jeremiah 29:11, where it says, "For I know the plans I have for you."
That's right.
So it's not really about what I believe. It's not just about me. because I was created. And when something is created, it has a purpose. Created with a purpose. And when we understand what our purpose is, if God created us and God says, I know the plans I have for you, then if I'm consulting, then I need to consult the one who created me, who has plans for me. And one thing that all the sciences may seek to do, and we'll get to that later again, is to deface the creative power of God, is to draw our attention from God to everything else, which is a distraction. And when we are distracted, then we lose time, we lose energy, we lose resources in, can I say, foolishness. Wasting precious time, wasting precious resources when we could have been used for greater service in the cause of God. Amen. And added to that, Daniel 2 gives a nice story of Nebuchadnezzar who had a dream. And he called out all those wise men and astrologers and astronomers and all the other owls you could find. And all the other men with supernatural powers and who could consult other higher beings and so on. And when the time came and they were asked, they couldn't answer. But when Daniel came and he consulted with God, God gave him the answer. He didn't know what happened in the king's room that night. He wasn't inside the king's dream, but God revealed it unto him. So all the other men who he called to consult and to find out, they couldn't answer. So truth stood the test of time, but lies were exposed. But when Daniel came on the scene and he called upon the God of heaven, the King of kings and Lord of lords, he was able to answer. So if there is anybody that we should go to, it's a call. When I call on Jesus, all things are possible.
Amen, amen. So from all that was said before, we are saying that the Bible does not support fortune tellers, palm readers, and we have scriptural evidence to back that up.
All right.
This is what we are saying here.
Mm-hmm. Of course, Pastor, and I would like you to, you see, we are not here just talking. Pastor, I would like you to get for us Deuteronomy 18, you know, and read maybe verse 10 to 12. While in the meantime, when you get in that, I can probably respond to something someone asked there, if they get a play lotto. If I believe in tattoo and gambling, of course I don't believe in that.
Okay.
And if someone gambles and win millions and bring it to the church, I do not own the church. The Bible says the cattle on a thousand hills belongs to God. So if someone comes to the church and deposit $10,000 in the offering plate, it's not my purview. I do not have the right to tell that person, well, we don't accept that money. That person brought that money there. If you're asking me, Pastor, look, $10,000. You're giving me $10,000. I won lot and take that to church. I'm not taking it. If you come to worship and you deposit your money, that's your money. You and God will deal with that. You understand what I'm saying, Pastor Guillaume?
That's right.
So, but people not normally ask that. People have said, Pastor, so if I win something and give the church, well, you and God will deal with that. But I'm saying, gambling is not of God. What I can say in this program here, without a doubt, gambling is not of God. The Bible says that, that's the next topic, Pastor Guillaume, but I just want to emphasize that. The Bible says, by the sweat of thy brow, somebody will say, yeah, sweat hard to gamble. No. By the sweat of thy brow, you shall eat bread. Not to go and gamble.
That's right.
You see, so
right.
Gambling is devil, like chance taking. I deal with God who gives, you know, not gambling.
That's
yes,
right.
I thought I wanted to say that, but the text, Pastor.
Just repeat the text again, Pastor.
Yes, Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 10 to 12.
Verses 10 to 12.
Yes.
All right, it says, there shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord. And because of these abominations, the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee.
Wonderful.
Powerful text.
Wonderful. So that's why we said at the beginning, there is, in the world of, we're talking about the supernatural, there is good and evil. So, and let us not take it lightly. There is good and evil. And the devil wants us to believe that he has no power, because when we believe that, he do whatever he wants with us. But let us not be caught off guard. The devil has some power. Yes? But we shouldn't be dealing with him. So, the fortune teller is operating under the auspices of the devil. Yes? The necromancer, necromancer is people who communicate with the dead. They operate under the auspices of the devil. And the palm readers, people who, you know, try to tell you your future by reading your palms based on the lines in your hand, Pastor Guillaume. Pastor Guillaume, if you want to know what's happened with us, yes, that's what they do. They're based on the lines, according to the direction, lines in your palm. Yes. They tell you what will happen to you. Mm. And people go to these people. Well, right now we have we're very technological, in our era. So we have the psychic persons, So you don't have to go to anywhere. You're going online.
Yeah.
People checking, people want to know if the business will fail. Well, I'm saying what we have to check, yes, is the supernatural man. Mm-hmm. You want the highest power, check God.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
And we don't have to go and do simi-dimi to check God. We pray and we talk to him. That's right. Pastor Lyon just made allusion to that.
That's right.
Because when the king called all the astrologers,
yes.
Remember, not the astronomers, the astrologers,
yes.
That's those who have the belief that they, based on the position of the stars and the planet, but nothing could come from that. Mm. When they called Daniel, Daniel came, and Daniel didn't have the answer because Daniel dealt with God. He asked for time, yes, in Daniel chapter 2, and he went with his three friends, and they consulted God. And in a night vision, the Bible says, God revealed it to Daniel. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
So the one that holds all the power reveals it to Daniel. If you want to know what's happening, some people are married, they want to know if the husband cheating, pastor, they're checking, all kind of people to find out that. Pray to God about it. Consult the higher power. God can reveal this unto you. You do not have to go by anybody, pay any money to find out what's going on with your wife or your children or any such thing. And God is saying, the Bible condemns that. God condemns these people who work for the devil. Essentially, pastor, they work for the devil. All of those persons, fortune tellers, palm readers, astrologers, and all of these persons, necromancers, they work for the devil. Charmers.
You know, Pastor, the discussion is very interesting, and as I look at the comments from the viewers, it seems as if we may have to have a session on gambling.
Okay.
You know, because a lot of folks seem to be going down that road and asking questions in that direction. So maybe we may need to consider that.
Sure.
We'll come back shortly. We'll just take a break here, and we'll take a promotion, crusade promotion at this time.
Looking back in the past some centuries ago, when you walked through the garden alone, you left even then your footprints of hope to be followed by men down the road. Adam and Eve, yes, they walked the path, but though that they'd hopelessly fail, but you sent a Savior 4,000 years later, so that men young and old now can tell.
Welcome back. If you just join us, we are discussing a very interesting, and the discussion is going, you know, it's lively. You know, the participants, the viewers, they are posting their comments, so they are involved in the whole discussion. And we have here Pastor Enoch Isaac and Pastor Bernard Lyons, who are expounding those questions using the scriptures. And the topic that we are discussing today is consulting your higher powers. Consulting your higher powers. So we want to continue the discussion here. And I want to read a text from Genesis chapter 1 and verse 14. It says, "And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years." The question I want to ask both of you, does this text indicate the supernatural nature of the heavenly bodies? In other words, the sun and the moon and the stars, the lights that have been placed, are there any supernatural elements about them?
All right, well, I like the question dearly, and I hope the question sticks with me, doesn't go anywhere. If there is really any power in those elements, those created elements, and notice I said those created elements. When we speak about power, of course, the sun has its heat, and the wind and the water, they have nature, is a powerful force all by itself. Sometimes man try to control nature, but in reality, we can't. Nature is just beyond us. When you look at it, nature, the firmaments and what is there, the sun and the moon, we have light, we have darkness. The sun rises in the east and sets in the west. And so you know that's a new day. That's the end of one day. It's light. So you know it's daylight. It's nighttime. And persons have made a link between the moon and even the way the tide is and so on. When you look at the moon and how the tide runs and the fishermen, sometimes they can tell you certain things based on the moon that is up at the time. And so I believe that nature is connected. Nature has nature, Mother Nature, as they say, has its connection. It's as though when one suffers, it's like everybody else starts suffering. And that is because there is a link in the chain when it comes to nature. But the reality is nature does not exist in and of itself. For in creation, the Bible says God created. And if God created, then God is the more powerful element or being or person in the process. So it cannot be the elements of nature that were created. That's why when the disciples were on the boat and Christ was in that same boat and there was a storm, things were rough, he was sleeping in peace, and they were fearful for their lives because nature was roaring against them. They thought they were going to die. And when Christ woke up, what he said? He spoke to the wind and the waves, and he said, "Peace, be still." It's only God who created could speak to the created, and the created listen to the voice of his creator.
Amen, amen, amen. So then why, Pastor, as you answer the question, why is it that people worship the sun? Because they associate that there is a God to the sun.
Yeah, well, the truth is I don't know, Pastor, why they worship the sun. but the powers, the sun is powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah, so is the moon. But as Pastor Lyons was saying, the power is not resident in the sun or the moon. The creator of the moon and the sun has the power. Right. And I think that's what makes persons believe now that hey, those heavenly bodies in itself a supernatural. No, they're not supernatural. They, but the Bible says, no. Should we believe in times and seasons based on the moon? Yes, the Bible says so, that they are given for times and seasons. So for planting, for the menstrual cycle, everything, you know, is a season. It's a time when the moon comes up, when it's going down. It gives indication for season. Mm-hmm. But the power is not resident in the moon or the sun. So there is no need to worship it. If we need to worship something, somebody, we worship the creator of that thing. So in that case, it's God. Because he created here in Genesis 1:14. So yes, we can believe it's there for the season, so we shouldn't say, okay, I don't believe in planting. No, the Bible says it's given for times and seasons. That's the moon. Yes, the sun, the heavenly bodies. But it's the creator of them all. Right? So the power is not resident in the moon or the sun itself. It's about the creator. No, I think that's a mistake persons be. Well, if it's for seasons, then we start believing astrology and the direction of, you know, yeah.
All right. So time is running out on us, but I want to ask this question, very important question. How can we know for certain we are consulting the correct spirit? Because there are other spirits. How do we know for certain? What guide does the Bible give? What scriptural evidence does the Bible give that we are actually worshiping or serving the correct spirit?
Yeah, maybe I can start, Pastor. In a minute, I'm not sure you can get that for us quickly. Isaiah 8:20. Yes. You know, Isaiah. To the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to their word, mm-hmm. it means that there are no light in them. I mean, there are many passages, but the Bible is simply saying, hey, in this world, how do you know? Mm-hmm. Because there are the supernatural, in the world of the supernatural, there is good and there is evil.
Yeah.
In the world of the supernatural, there is good and there is evil. And you do not have to be. You do not have to be operating on the world to be considered evil. Everything and anything that is not godly or godlike is otherwise, is evil. Yes? So anyone, if I start speaking, but I'm saying things contrary, it doesn't matter how nice I dress in suit, and it doesn't matter that. Yeah? If I'm saying things contrary to the word of God, then it means that I'm not directed by the Holy Spirit. I'm being directed by other power. So there are many other powers out there. The Lawrence, Lodge, and Freemason, the Illuminati, Pastor Guillaume, all of these things are directed by the evil spirits, by the evil powers. They are, the persons join them for power, but these powers are not godly powers. Mm-hmm. Yes? These powers are not godly powers. We have to join, to receive powers from God, we have to join no society. Yes, we have to join no society. Daniel prayed. Moses prayed. We pray to God and God gives us. We don't have to join a society and go in various meetings and that kind of stuff for persons to see us and then to get power. So to the law and to the testimony, if they speak contrary to the word of God, if they're doing anything contrary to the word of God, we know it is not of God.
Okay, and then we have 1 John 4:2. We speak about if they can confess that Christ came in the flesh, then you know that these are authentic individuals. And also Matthew 7:20, which speaks of by the fruits you shall know them. So it's really about persons actually telling the future. That's what they're really trying to do most of the time. So these are some of the passages of scripture they can use to simply test them as prophets. And of course, what they say should come to pass.
I must say that when we are enjoying ourselves in the Lord, time runs quickly. And I want to just give you the opportunity to, you know, just to comment on the last question here. Can you please comment or explain Revelation chapter 16, verse 13 and verse 14? It says here, and I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet, for they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Can you just give us a synopsis on that two verses?
Okay, Pastor, my comment on that would in relation to what we're talking about is just to state and to remind us that in the world of the supernatural there is good and evil and there are evil spirits. We have to remember that, you see? The Bible says, then I saw three impure spirits. Not pure ones, impure ones.
That's right.
Yes, there are evil spirits out there. Yes, they look like frogs. You know, not going to the details of it, but verse 14 says they are demonic spirits. Yes, demonic, not godly spirits. They are impure spirits. They are demonic spirits, and look what they do. They perform signs. They have power. They operate in the world of the supernatural, you see? And they go to the kings of the world to gather them to battle. They influence, they function in parliaments and in Congress. The high people of the world. Yes, deceptive. That's how they function. They're very deceptive. So we have to be very mindful, because sometimes you know, if someone can do this, or if someone does that, then that has to come from God. No, there are evil spirits that have serious power. Yes. We can't contend with them except we are hidden Jesus. So we have to be mindful that when we consult him, that we ensure that we consult godly powers, because there are spirits, they are not functioning under the auspices of God. They are powerful and they can perform miracles and have a strict, because they say miracles. Well, if they are doing miracles, that means lots of evil spirits performing miracles. They're not godly
indeed.
Spirits. You have to be mindful.
That's right.
Careful
indeed.
Of that.
Indeed. Pastor Lyon.
All right, so for me, in that area there, we speak about those three beings and those three unclean spirits, and references also made to the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. And so out of them, the whole intention, as was mentioned before, is really to deceive.
Yes.
So whatever is spoken, the objective is the same, to deceive. And we know that Satan, which is that old serpent, that dragon, that was cast out, he has one intention, that is to deceive. And when you can deceive somebody, you could manipulate them and get them to do what you want them to do. And if we read deeper, references made somewhere along the Battle of Armageddon and so on, that last great battle and so on and so forth. So it's really about taking people's mind away from God, away from the great creator, and throwing the minds of individuals into fancy tales and myths and fallible truths, so to speak, erroneous ideas, so that we will not know exactly what is happening. We will be deceived, and by being deceived, then how can we then believing as God wants us to live? And that's why, can I just add, that we should know the word. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God.
Oh, yes.
A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And that is how we would know when we are being deceived. When we know the word and we allow it to be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path.
Amen.
Psalm 119,
Amen.
105.
Amen. So here, viewers and listeners, we see here that the devil, he began with deception, even in heaven, and he will end with deception. That's what he is. So my encouragement to you today, don't be deceived, because the Bible says that he has the power to transform himself even as an angel of light.
Deception.
And so please do not be deceived. Don't be involved in evil. If you have to, when you worship, always remember that you worship the higher power, the all-powerful God, the all-present, the all-knowing God, the all-sufficient God. I urge you, I encourage you to remain faithful to that God. I want to thank my panelists today, Pastor Enoch Isaac and Pastor Lyons, for the great discussion. You can join us this evening at 8:30. I know that the crusade is on, but it will still be aired at that time. But I want to just remind you to join us this evening at 7:30 as well for the crusade. And I know that you will be tremendously blessed. Remember to share the link, invite persons, and let us be a part of this great experience as we look forward for the second coming of Jesus Christ. May God continue to richly bless you and to keep faithful even as we go through this new year. I'm going to ask Pastor Enoch Isaac to close us off in prayer at this time.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day and another pastor's corner where we can share light on the issues at hand, consulting the higher powers. We thank you for the responses that was given. And Father, we pray that your audience, your people, were tremendously blessed. May you continue to inspire us to hold such programs to enlighten your people. Dismiss us now with your blessings, we pray, in Jesus' name.
Amen.